Let's pray. Father, again, we pray for your presence, and we ask that you touch every heart in ways that would bring results. In Jesus' name, amen. So we said, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You remember? That was last one that we finished. Give us today our daily bread. The first part of the prayer is praises. The last part is praises. Second part focuses on God. Third part focuses on us. Praises, praises, God, you. Okay? After you focus on God enough, then you can ask your needs. Now, when you ask your needs, the Bible, I don't want you to think that we cannot present our needs before the Lord, because the Bible says clearly, cast your cares upon Him. The problem is not that we present our needs to God. The problem is that we don't present our needs to God. We bug Him, we pester Him to death, we push Him, we don't respect His will, we don't even know His will, we don't accept His will, we don't trust Him. And when we present our needs, we make a plan and tell Him what to do, when to do it, and how to do it. It's like God knows nothing, and we need to tell Him what to do, and He just has that power. If you remember, there was a story called Aladdin and the Lamp. And there was a lamp that was a magic lamp. And if you owned that lamp, and you did that on the lamp, a big Schwarzenegger came from the lamp. Say, Master, what do you want? I want a Mercedes. Okay, and you have a Mercedes. That's what we consider prayer. We tell the Lord what to do, and He must do it. Prayer is when God tells us what to do, not when we tell Him what to do. And if we ask Him something, we allow His will and we trust Him. So we should not use prayer as means to get what we need. Prayer is not a matter of consumerism. Prayer is a matter of relationship. Okay. So when we present our needs, it's okay to present as long as after we give God permission to work, we trust Him and move on. Now listen carefully. If we walk with God closely, that He can lead us and use us, then it is safe for God to give us more power and more means, because we will use them properly. So, I want to go a little deeper here. For instance, cast your cares upon Him. People think that they need to tell God about the problems, but the word in Greek is not tell your cares. It's cast, and it's not cast like give Him your cares. No, that's a different word in Greek. The word here, it's ekbalo. Ekbalo, it's used just a few times in the Bible. It's used when they would throw rocks to kill Jesus. It's used when Jesus would cast out demons. And ekbalo, it's also used when Jesus says the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are just a few. Pray that the Lord would send workers. In Greek, it's ekbalo. Pray that the Lord would cast workers. Means that they don't want to go. They like to live comfortable lives. And God has to throw them out to work. Okay? Or it also could be translated that the Lord would cast the demons out from the workers that distract them from the work. Could be translated that way too. But the last way to be translated, ekbalo, is when you have something and throw it away so far, so hard, that is so far that you cannot touch it and take it back. It's not yours. So basically, what is Jesus saying when you cast your cares upon Him? It's not that you tell Him and then you take your problem, put it on your shoulders and keep carrying it. It's when you go to Jesus with your problem, you throw it so far that you cannot take it back. It's not yours anymore. It's Jesus' problem. So basically, you give it to Him and it's not yours. Therefore, you move on and choose to trust Him, and you don't worry about that anymore. That takes a little faith. But if you make a decision to move on, it's going to pay off. You follow me? So we can tell Jesus our problems, but we should not push Him. We just give it to Him and let Him trust Him. He loves you enough. Move on. Does it make any sense? You are too quiet. Either you are asleep after the lunch, or you are thinking. Yes. It depends. Again and again, I say it depends. In the Bible, prayer always, 99% of the times, is related to, even if we don't see it because of translation, is related to a time frame. And sometimes they pray once, sometimes they pray a day for it, sometimes they pray 3 days, but you always see a time. They pray 7, they pray 10 days, they pray 30 days, they pray 40 days. I never see in the Bible more than 40 days praying for something. But it depends. And I advise people usually, the bigger the problem, the longer you spend. But do not spend forever, because then you don't leave room for God to be God, to make a decision. You want Him to do what you want. Therefore, when you say, Jesus prayed 2 hours in Gethsemane, I saw your hand. He prayed 1 hour, he went to the disciples, they were asleep, and he prayed another 1 hour, and then he said, okay, may your will be done. And he gave up. Basically, Jesus did have a time frame to pray for something. And then, after you decide how long you are going to pray for it, then you say, nevertheless, I'm going to accept your will. And then you leave it with Him and move on. Hold on a second. It's Him and then you. Yes?
What about the story of the widow?
Okay, I'll get there.
Okay. What are you saying in class about how the numbers mean something?
Okay, I'll get there. So... story of the widow. She goes to the judge. Justice! And the judge, go away. And now the judge goes to Olive Garden to eat. She goes there and, justice! And he says, she embarrasses me. I am with my wife and my friends eating lunch. Go away. And then he goes playing golf. And she's there on the course. Justice! And all his friends shake their head. Can you do something? We want to play. And then he goes to courthouse. And she's on the stairs. And when he walks, justice! And he gets so tired. And he says, okay, after about 6 months, okay? Now, is that the way we should do with God? Is that a lesson in the Bible that would teach us what to do? In the Greek grammar, the grammar there is called lesson by contrast. That means, don't do that way. Do just the opposite. Because the grammar, it's a lesson by contrast. And I'm going to prove it to you. That judge doesn't represent God. Represents Satan. Because that was a good mayor of Chicago. He was corrupted. He was evil. He didn't have any shame for God, any fear of God, any shame of people. He was all bad. And the Bible says, if even that evil guy eventually did justice, don't you think in the next verse that God will answer when His people pray? And then He says in the following verse, He will answer, and I tell you that He will answer quickly is the word. Basically, the lesson is, you don't have to. You don't have to push Him. He loves you. If you who are evil, moreover, God who is good will give His children. If He takes care of the birds, if He takes care of, you follow me? He will answer. The point is, you got to trust Him. And in fact, a few verses later, if you read in the next paragraph, next story, Jesus says, do not repeat the same words again and again and again. That's the pagans do. In fact, the Greek word is do not babble. When we repeat the same words, it's like babbling from the word Babylon. Blah, 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 the same words again and again. God doesn't want that. He heard you. Enough. I heard it. Like Moses. Let me go in the problem. Let me go. God, enough. I heard you. I know. No. The answer is no. So, you understand what I'm trying to say? It's not that God doesn't know. It's not that we need to convince God to change His mind. In fact, it should be different. We just give Him permission to work. He knows. He has a solution. Think about it, the way we see God. We are influenced by the Greek culture. We, the Western society, have about 90% of our culture coming from the Greek culture. In the Greek culture, gods are moody. And you got to do something to please them, to convince them to answer. Therefore, you keep Sabbath, you give money, you do something for God, and then He does something for you. We don't believe that. There is nothing you can do for God, and God loves you anyway. For instance, if you have a brother who just won the lottery, and he won $500 million, is that enough? What do you think? Okay, 600? You pick the number. He won $700 million. Can you understand the number? $700 million. That's the big number, you know? And you just lost your job, and you'll be foreclosed in 2 weeks, and your car broke, and you have no money to pay tuition, and you have no money for food. You are broke. And your brother comes to you and says, okay, how much do you owe? Well, I owe $150,000 to the house. He says, okay, he writes down $150,000. I owe about $20,000 for my kids' tuition, and he writes down, okay, so far it's $170,000. And I owe this and that to electricity, to the power company, to the telephone. Okay, altogether about $170,000. What is $170,000 from $700 million? It's not even a drop in a bucket. So he says, listen, I'm going to write a check here, $1 million. Is that enough for you? You are happy? Okay, $1 million. He gives you the check. And then he says, don't go and buy a car. I want to get you a car. And he goes, what car do you like? Eh? Hey, guys, what car?
Ferrari.
BMW. What do you want? Mercedes.
I want a Dodge.
He gets an S600 Mercedes. You know what is an S600 convertible? That sport that has 12 cylinders, power, crazy. Okay. He goes on an S600. It's around $160,000. Okay? And he goes to the dealer. I want that car. And I want it black. My brother likes black. I want that car. I want the convertible S600 series sport. Okay, that's $160,000. I don't care. I have the money. I could pay cash. Okay. Put GPS. Oh, it's going to be another $2,000. Put a GPS. Put sensors in the bumper. It's going to add another $2,000. Okay. Huh? Heating seats. Massaging the seats. Is that good? Okay. Add this. Add that. And he would add, and the car goes from 160 to 180. And he says, okay, I gave him $1 million. I'm going to take care of the car. I can hardly wait to see his face when he sees a Mercedes. Whoa, he's going to jump like crazy. He's going to be happy. Okay. And then they say, well, we have a problem with the car. What's the problem? We need another $5. We need to wash the car. Oh, I'm not going to pay $5. I just paid $1 million and another $180,000. Do you think he says that? Or he says, what's $5? Wash it. Wax it. Make it nice. What do you think? Is he going to nickel and dime for $5, or he will pay to wash the car? What? The stinker, he can wash his own car. I'm not going to pay $5 for him. Is he going to pay so the car is clean and shiny?
Yes.
That's what we do about God. He gave Jesus on the cross. And he's going to nickel and dime for $5. When we ask him for a job, what is that for God? We don't understand God enough to trust him, to wait for his answers. That's the problem. Do you follow me? We need to see the big picture. We need to see the big picture. So, basically, remind me a little later about numbers. So, basically, when you go to God, you need to see the big picture to understand that God is love. And not just words, but believe. When God is love, then you can go to him with anything, but then you got to trust him. Therefore, after you give him permission, not because he doesn't know, he knows. He has a solution before you have a problem. In fact, he had a solution before you were born. He knew all your days, all your problems. He knows. When you go to him, you don't tell him what to do. He knows what to do. You give him permission to work, and then you choose to trust him. And the problem we have, we pray more because we doubt. When Abraham believed, it was considered to him as righteousness. In Hebrew, I told you what it means, didn't I? Hebrew translation says he was considered as righteous as God himself. So when you believe, when Sarah believed in that moment, she conceived, she got pregnant. The problem we have, we doubt God. When you make a choice, you don't need to feel it. You don't need to understand it. When you make a choice to believe, then you move on because you believe that God is working. You may not see the answer right away because answer to prayer, it's a process. It's not an event. You start praying, God starts working. It may take a while. But when you believe, you move on and decide to trust him. When you make that decision, it's going to reward you big time because later you look back and you see that God did work. He's going to give you strength for the next trial. Because if you know that he worked last time, it's easier for you second time to decide to trust him and wait upon the Lord. Don't act yourself. Wait. Let him work. And then you move on. And you see that he works. And then third time and then fourth time. I told you in one of the classes, I don't remember what class, about my kids in Norway, didn't I? What class was the freshmen?
The juniors.
When we went to Norway, no offense, I didn't. They are juniors. How could you call them freshmen? Yeah. So we went to Norway to school. We went to school. And they didn't give visa to our kids. And I was not about to spend 1 year of school without my children. That was one was like 3-4 years old. One was about 7 years old. I was not about to spend 1 year without the kids. So they were supposed to come 2 weeks later. And the embassy refused to give them visa. And the law said that they have to wait 6 months before applying again. I'm not going to stay 6 months with all my kids. So I went there in Norway to the passport service and I asked them for a visa for the kids. And they said, no, the law says that you wait 6 months. Basically, we are not going to break the law of the country for you. I said, well, then I don't stay in school, then I go home. And they said, why would you care? Go home. So the school insisted, please don't leave. It was a self-supporting school in close to Oslo, in Scottsdale, between Drammen and Oslo. Oslo is the capital of Norway. Beautiful place, good school, good Christian school. You would learn their Bible, you would learn their organic agriculture, healthy lifestyle, massage, all type of good stuff. That's first time in my life when I learned about gardening. First time when I planted carrots, I planted them like potatoes, like 1 foot under the ground. They never came up. But I was learning. I was learning. Right now I have a beautiful garden. I have a garden that you will be impressed. Okay, so, am I right, Cameron?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So, I have pictures with lettuce that I hold one head of lettuce on both hands. It is so big. No chemicals, no nothing, no fertilizer, just pure clean. And I used just natural methods. For instance, those slugs that eat your lettuce, I don't spray my plants. I take yeast that you use to make bread, put yeast in a plastic cup, put it in the ground, and all the slugs from like 50 feet radius come there and they drink and they are drunk. And then I just take them on a shovel and throw them away. Very simple recipes to take care of the garden, very simple. I could tell you more, but right now, I'm not going to go into that. We talk about prayer. Yes?
All that you've been saying about prayer, what does 1 Thessalonians 5, when it says pray without ceasing?
That's different. I'm going to tell you what is that. That in Greek doesn't even say pray. It says have a relationship, be connected. Basically that we should not break the relation, the connection with God. It's not talking about asking something without ceasing. It's about don't go far from God. That's the translation. We think prayer is when we ask something. Prayer is when we communicate. So, back to the... Yes?
I just have a quick question.
Say a quick question.
Okay. I don't remember exactly what the verse is, but something about there's certain things that we should not pray for. You know what I'm talking about? What does that mean? Or what does that have to...
That's very difficult, very complicated. But we'll address it. So... I decided to have a time of prayer. Not 2 hours, not 40 days. But the school would persist. The principal said, please don't go back. Please stay in school. Please don't go. Please, 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 please. I said, then you call the passport service. He called and they said, no, 6 months. And then they apply again and they may be rejected again. Why? Well, we are afraid if he gets all his family, he may never go back to Romania. I had no intention to move to Norway. I went there for school. In Romania, I had a good life. In Norway, I had nothing. So, my classmates talked to me, and we decided together that we are going to put it before the Lord for 30 days. And if the kids come in 30 days, I stay in school. If not, 30th day after supper, we leave. And they said, the school principal, impossible! The law says 6 months. I said, well, my God can break their law. Yeah, God can. He can. We forget God can do anything. We pray small prayers because we pray prayers that we can do. So we don't need God to do because we don't trust that He will do it. We doubt. And after we pray, we go ahead and do it. Instead of praying big prayers that we cannot do, and let Him work. So I said, you know, God has to bring them in 30 days. If not, it means that I should not be here. So I give up school and go home. We prayed 30 days. And after 30 days, I was determined not to push the Lord one day or 1 hour over the 30 days. But maybe God doesn't want me to be in that place. So after 30 days, I go home. I didn't know anything. When I went to the passport service, he said, 6 months, I'm not going to break the law. Well, I give up school then. Give up, I don't care. He didn't care. He didn't even talk to me too much. He said, next. I was nothing for him. Well, meanwhile, and the school called him. He said, I don't care. He can give up school. I don't care. Meanwhile, they had a meeting in the Norwegian Congress to talk about immigration. Because they had too many Arabs immigrating to Norway. And they wanted to put a limit. And he thought, I am one of them and I want to move to Norway. So the chief of the passport talks to the prime minister and says, and all these people want to move here, like that Romanian guy. He says, if you don't give me visa in 30 days for my kids, I give up school. Why would I care? And the prime minister says to him, you should care. Your job is to care for people. And he says, well, I cannot care for everybody. He says, well, you got to do your best. Tell me about the story. Well, some family from Romania, they are here in school, and if we don't let the kids come within 30 days, they give up school and go home. How old are the kids? Well, one is about 3, one is about 7. And you keep that family separated from their kids? Give them visa. I cannot. I lose my job. It's the law. The king has to sign an exception, a decree, to allow them to come. The prime minister moves tables during the lunchtime, and he goes and talks to the king of Norway. And the king says, give me a paper. He signs a petition that my kids should get a visa right away, against the law. They call the embassy in Bucharest. The embassy calls my father-in-law, bring the kids right away. That was in the 29th day. But my father-in-law is not home, and the kids are in school. So they call again next morning, bring the kids. My father-in-law takes the kids, runs to the Norwegian embassy in Bucharest. They get visa against any law because the king signed. They get a visa. They go to an agency, get plane tickets, get on a plane, and get in Norway 15 minutes before we left. We packed. We were ready. We ate. We said a prayer. We were ready to go. And we get a phone call. The kids are in the airport. Go and pick them up. And said, how? We did nothing about it. We didn't even know. And so the school principal called the passport service. How in the world? Well, let me tell you the story. The prime minister talked to the king, and the king signed the petition. And we had to call because the king said so. So we called the embassy. This is the story. Go and pick them up. They are in the airport waiting. We drove 30 minutes to Oslo, picked up the kids. In the 30th day, 15 minutes before we left. I mean, God answers in the last moment always. I don't like that, but whatever. So a time frame, and then you are willing to do whatever God wants you to do. But you don't push God. You just trust Him and then you move on. Okay? You cast your cares upon Him and leave them there with Him. You don't have to help Him. He doesn't need your help unless He tells you to do something. Okay? So, give us today our daily bread. In the Lord's Prayer, there is something called in the Greek grammar reversible that we don't have in our grammar. That means that you do it as you are done unto. You follow me? Forgive us as we forgive others. That's a reversible. Basically, if you don't forgive, you cannot be forgiven. The same here. When he says give us today, in Greek grammar is give us as we give others. It's not translated properly. In the English, it's very poor translation. If it is there, give us, not give me, so we can actually share, if I put it in my words. Basically, many times we ask the Lord to do what He asked us to do. God says, go and do this job. And I say, okay, Lord, please go and do this job. We throw it back to Him. God didn't, you cannot pray, God be with the poor. God asked you to be with the poor. And if you have two coats, that's good enough. You share one. And just as you share, God can give you more because you share. When I understood this, it was a little heavy on me. I was in Wisconsin, and I was not in business as I used to be to make a lot of money. I was actually living on a pastor's salary, and it was before my wife got a job. So it was tight. It was really from salary to salary. And we would get the salary, and we would pay it first check. The very first one was tight, and then put money aside for offerings. And then we paid the bills, and every month after we paid the bills, we had left over about 150 to 200 to live. And every month, somehow, God made it last enough that we could survive the whole month. It's the principle of chewing gum. You can chew it forever, it never ends. God did the same with our money, the leftover money. We would somehow use that 150 for anything we needed that month, and it still lasted a month. I cannot explain it. It's just I tell you that we always had food and paid our bills. We never had more, but we never had less. When we had an emergency, the roof broke, we still fixed the roof, and we still had 150. So, what happened? I paid tight that month. I paid the bills, and I took the money to pay tuition for my kid who was in our Adventist school. And I knew if I keep the money in the house, we get in a crisis, we spend them. So I said, I'm going to go and pay, so the money is not in the house, so I'm not tempted. I got the money in my pocket, I got in the car, and drove. The school is just 4 blocks from where we lived. So I drove around four blocks. When I get close to the school, it's raining, there is a lady crying in the rain. And I recognize her, I baptized her just 2 months before. So I stopped the car and I said, hey, why are you crying? No, I cannot tell you, I am ashamed to tell you. Did you do something wrong? Oh, no. Then why are you ashamed? Well, they had to lay off over 150 people in the GM plant, and I lost my job because I was among the last one to be hired, so among the first one to be fired. So she says, I didn't tell anybody because I don't want to ask the church for help. And then she said, I didn't pay rent for 2 months, and they evicted me from the apartment. And she had 2 small children. And then she said, we didn't pay power, and they cut the electricity. And then she said, we don't have food, and we don't have telephone. And she said, all I had was 2 potatoes. I went to the neighbor, cooked those 2 potatoes, my kids ate, and now we don't know what to do. And I prayed, and God didn't answer. I said, God did answer. You just need to wait for the answer. And it comes never early, but never late. It comes in the right time. So God impressed me, and I said, get in the van. Come up here. And instead of paying tuition, with the school tuition money, I went to Aldi, because it's cheap, you can buy a lot, you know. And I said, okay, what do you need? And then I realized, what a question, she had nothing. So I went to the shelf, and I got 2 gallons of unhealthy milk, I put it in the cart, I looked to her face, and she smiled, okay, it's good. Then I got unhealthy eggs, I looked to her face, she smiled, good. Then I got potatoes, then I got onion, and then I got cans of beans and whatever, and I filled the cart, and I said, hold it. Why? Just hold it. I took a second cart, filled it, said, do you think is this enough? Oh, this is going to last the whole month, Pastor, and she started to cry. I said, okay. I went to the cashier, paid for it, and I said, give me the name of the landlord. She gave me the name, I called the landlord, I said, hey, what church do you go to? Why do you want to go to my church? I said, just answer the question. I go to this Baptist church in the city here. Da, da, da. I said, okay, listen carefully. How much does she owe you? Oh, that's the reason you called me? I said, just tell me how much you owe. She owes me so much. I said, I don't have that money. I have just half of what she owes you. I'm going to sacrifice and pay half, and you sacrifice and forgive half. I cannot do that. I create a precedent, and then I have to forgive everybody. Yes. Yes, and you will. No, I cannot do that. I said, are you a Christian? Oh, yes, I go to this church. I said, no, you are not a Christian. And I said, I know your pastor. I'm going to call him and tell him what a Christian you are. Oh, I don't care. I said, listen, you don't know me. I'm crazy. I am going to call your pastor. And then I'm going to call the news and make a big deal that you throw out in the street a lady in the winter that has 2 babies. And you owe, she owned 550 apartments in the city. She was filthy rich. I said, I'm going to call the news on you. And I'm going to call the TV, local TV. I'm going to go against you with all my energy. Because you are not a Christian. Yes, I am a Christian. Yes, you are not. You are not. Do you have children? Yes, I do. Do you tell them about Jesus? Yes. Well, they will never be Christians because they see what they do, what they see, not what they hear. You don't give them a good example. We should love our neighbors. When Jesus says, I was poor, I was naked, you don't care about Jesus, because if you did, you would care about Jesus' children. So I'm going to go against you. You don't. You are not a Christian. Shame on you. He says, why do you say that? I said, duh. We talk about helping somebody who lost her job. Well, I cannot do that every month. I said, I didn't ask you to do it every month. You do it this time. Well, I guess I can do it one time. Just don't tell anybody. She forgave half. I said, put it in writing. I don't want to call again tomorrow. I paid half. And then I called my church members. And I called the elders. And I said, listen, this Sabbath you don't see me. I'm not coming to church. Why? There is a condition for me to come and preach. You raise money. You don't take from the church budget. You take from your pockets. And you pay her electricity. If not, you don't have a sermon. And next Sabbath, I'm going to ask her, if you didn't pay electricity, you don't have a sermon. Call the conference, move me. I don't care. And they knew that I am serious. I follow up when I say something. So they raised money and they paid her electricity. Man, she hugged me. She kissed me. She cried. And she would not stop. She would not let me go. Thank you. Thank you. I said, okay, that's enough. You know, she made my day. I went home and I told my wife, honey, I didn't pay tuition. And she said, you spend the money? I said, you know me better than that. You lost the money? No. What happened? And I told her the story. And I said, we usually pay our bills. This time we cannot pay tuition. She said, honey, you are a pastor. You did what is right. Don't worry. God will provide. You know God better than that. And praise the Lord for a good wife, you know, supportive. And she said, don't worry about it. If we need to pay tuition, God will provide. If not, we don't need our kids there. Don't worry. We can homeschool them. I said, okay, okay, good, no problem. 2:30, I go to pick up the mail, a check from IRS. They did a mistake 3 years before in our taxes. And they send the money back. It was exactly to the penny what I had to pay tuition. I'm not going to go in details. It doesn't always come back in the mail 2:30, but it always pays back. Basically, God says, it's not my bread. Give me my bread. You got to share. You got to care. Our bread. Give us our bread. Basically, what I give you, you got to share. If you don't, then you don't deserve the blessing. So that's the way you pray when you pray for a blessing. You don't have just self in mind, because then God cannot answer. You have to have in mind all those around you and not feel that, what am I going to do? How am I going to pay the bills? God knows that. God told you to share. And in fact, God didn't tell just the rich people to share, but everybody. Even the widow. You remember? Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us as we forgive. We talked a little about it when I told you about the mean 92 years old lady. You remember? This is the problem that we have with forgiveness. On the cross, the good news is that Jesus paid for us. He says, this is the Lamb that takes away the sin of the world. How much means the sin of the world? How many people? So basically, on the cross, Jesus paid for everybody, for every sin. Do you follow? Why some people feel that some sins in their life are not covered? It doesn't make any sense. Because on the cross, Jesus paid for everybody, for all sins. Basically, he paid for it. The problem we have is not that he didn't forgive. It's that we don't trust him enough to cash the check. He gave us the $1 million check and we say, this is fake. And he forgives you and you don't forgive yourself. And because you don't have faith, you are not forgiven. It's not that his blood is not sufficient. It's that your faith is not sufficient. So forgiveness comes in a few stages. Number one, if you confess. So what is number one? Confession. You confess your sin. Number two, You believe that you are forgiven. Faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. Hebrew. Okay? And number three, remain. Confess, believe, remain. That means John 15. Separated from me, you are nothing. You are going to sin again. So, think about Jacob. We talked a little about Jacob, didn't we? Think about Jacob. He was a good Adventist. He even had dreams. How many of you have dreams? I don't. You see, he even had a dream. Angels going up and down. But then he's this type of Seventh-day Adventist. He says, if you bless me, if you bring me back, if you keep me safe, then I will pay tithe and serve you. What if I don't bless you? All based on conditions. Lord, if you do this and that, I'll do this and that for you. We try to buy God. We try to negotiate. It's not unconditional like Job. Curse him. God didn't bless you. I don't care. If he blesses me or not, I'll still love him. I'll still praise him. Our praises are very much dependent on blessings instead of being dependent on relationship. I don't know if you understand what I say. So basically, Jacob was kind of an Adventist that depends very much on answers to prayer. If God doesn't answer, he would get depressed. If God doesn't talk, he would get depressed. Instead of just trusting the Lord. Moreover, Jacob would pray for something and then never wait upon the Lord. Go ahead and do it. God said, I'll give you the birthright. He said, okay, I'll take care of it. And he deceived his father and got a birthright. He thought he didn't. Because what God blesses is blessed forever. If he got the blessing, why ask for a blessing later? He never got a blessing. So Jacob deceived his brother and his father and his father-in-law and everybody, and he would always have a solution. How the sheep could be born this way, how this can be done this way. He never waits upon the Lord. He would pray and then go ahead and help God because God is so weak, he needs help. And after a life, when Jacob came back home, he was 60 years old. I don't know if you knew that. After a life of running away from God, finally at Jabbok River. Jabbok River is so wide. It's about 2 feet wide. At Jabbok River, he learns that his brother comes to 300 soldiers to kill him. So he prays, Lord, save us. And then he makes a plan. This wife and her children, you go left. This wife and her children, you go right. And the servants and their children, you go straight. If my brother comes from that direction, he's going to kill those, but the others will be saved. What a good plan. I don't think you want to be in that group, do you? That's not a good plan. Okay. And he doesn't take care of the problem. So he's alone, smart guy, on the other side of the river. And somebody attacks him. When it rains, it pours. Trouble doesn't come alone. And as he is there praying, somebody attacks him. And he's fighting the whole night. And nobody wins. Nobody wins. And they push into each other. When he puts more effort, the other guy puts more effort. When he slows down, the other guy slows down. And man, it seems that he has power, but he doesn't use it, but he doesn't let it go. And he doesn't get it. And after a whole night, when they are perspired and tired, the other guy says, let me go, the morning is coming. It doesn't make any sense for me. A thief says, let me go, the morning is coming. No, why do you attack me? And the other guy touches him on the hip. Bang! His hip jumps out of socket. Pops out. Oopsie, this is no human being, this is God. He was fighting God all along. I believe that he was fighting God and running from God, not from people, not fighting enemies, his brother, his father-in-law. He was not fighting enemies all his life. He was actually fighting God. Because all things that happen in life, they don't happen by chance. If God didn't want them to happen, they will not happen. If God allows them, we may need to learn a lesson. And instead of learning the lesson, we say, please solve this problem. Instead of slow down, if God allowed it, then you may need to learn something. Lord, I have a problem. It means that you try to tell me something. What do you want me to learn? We pray for help instead of praying for change. And God allowed the problem to help you change. Does it make sense? But you don't care what God wants. We care what we want. help me with this problem. And you are going to keep having problems before you change that problem. Okay, so he says, I'm not going to let you go before you bless me. And the Lord is deaf. He needs hearing aids. Because like my grandpa, when he was 103, I would say, Grandpa, how are you doing? And he would say, 103, son. I didn't ask you how old you are. How are you doing? Oh, John. I know your name, Grandpa. Tell me, how are you doing? Yeah, good weather. You have to scream loud in his ears. Ah, I'm doing good. God doesn't hear well because he says, bless me. And God says, what's your name? Oh, come on. Tell me if you bless me or not. What's your name? Why would God not answer yes or no and ask him his name? Because that's where he dropped it. When his father asked him, what's your name? He said, Esau. And he is not Esau. He was Jacob. So you are going to face trouble before you face who you are. You own who you are. And it starts there. Blessings don't come. Change doesn't come before you confess who you are. You cannot play with the Lord. It doesn't work that way. So he had to acknowledge, I am Jacob. He had to say it. That means he said, Lord, I am a deceiver. That's who I am. I deceive everybody. That's what people believe about me. And this is actually who I am. As soon as he was willing to confess, what happened? God forgave. God blessed. God changed his name. Name, change of name in Hebrew culture means change of character. God changed his character. New birth, new heart, new mind. Moreover, that night, God showed himself in a dream to his brother and said, don't touch him. So basically, he didn't have to fight. Because when you confess, God goes before you and solves your problems and fights your enemies even before you get there. You don't need to fight. Your salvation is going to be in peace and serenity. You don't have to struggle. You just need to do what God told you to do. In the Bible, I never see Israel actually fighting. They go to war, Jehoshaphat, and they sing. When you go to war, you take a sword. And God goes before them and kills their enemies. They go to war and they have a light and a trumpet. And God kills the enemies. They go to war and they walk around the city. And God kills the enemies. Because when you do what God tells you to do, he's going to go ahead of you and fight your battles that you don't need to struggle. When we struggle because we don't trust God. And we do what we want to do. You follow? It starts with confession. And then you have faith to believe that he forgave you. And then you remain in Christ. And when you believe, you have to really process. He forgave me. Don't we learn about Jesus' robe of righteousness? That when you confess, you are forgiven. He takes your sins upon him and gives you his righteousness. Do you even process what that means? He would give you his righteousness. Isn't that enough reason to jump up and down and go crazy, go nuts? Be happy? We don't even believe. We should rejoice. Hey, I am forgiven. So, this is the reason. Now, listen carefully what I say, because this is rough. This is the reason people don't forgive others around. They are mean and rude because they are not forgiven themselves. You cannot give what you don't have. If they have not experienced grace, how in the world can they give grace? You know the saying, the more you walk among flowers, the more likely you smell like flowers. Well, let me change it a little. The more you walk among grace, the more you share grace. And people who don't share grace are the people who never experience grace. They talk about God a bunch, but they never knew God's grace and love. Because if they accept that they are forgiven, and they are as righteous as God, if they accept it by faith, they cannot be mean to the others. You follow me? So as you accept forgiveness, you have no problem to forgive the others. And as you forgive, you can go back to God for forgiveness. That's the way it goes. Forgive us and do not lead us into temptation. And I talked about that before, and I said that to lead us into temptation, it's actually how many translations? Could be translated four ways. Number one, do not lead us. Number two, do not let us go. Number three, draw us close to you in Greek. And number four, in Greek it says, draw us close because alone we slip into temptation. The Catholic translation, Vulgata, that we have all the translations from, the way they understand God, God is a tyrant. He's going to torture you for eternity in fire. And you'll, oops, oops, it's hot. And he's going to just burn you there a million, a trillion years. That's the Catholic mindset. So please don't leave me. Yes, I'm going to push you into temptation. Please, Lord, don't push me. Yes. That's not God. God doesn't push anybody. God cannot be tempted to do evil. God is good. God doesn't want you to sin. He doesn't lead you into temptation. Satan does. And sometimes you do it to yourself. Okay? So the translation that I believe should be there, if the word could be translated in four ways, I believe is the last one. Draw us close to you, because alone we will go into temptation. That's the way we are. You follow me? So we went quick, and then he says, for thy is the kingdom, you end with praises. We went quick through the Lord's Prayer. Now, do you have questions about this before we go a little longer? Yes. Hebrew numbers. Hebrew numbers. How long do we go? How long time do we have? I'll get there. 2:35. So we have another 15 minutes. Okay. In Hebrew culture, numbers don't have just valorical, numerical value, but they also have symbolical value. That means that every number means something. Three means determined. Trinity. Some that cannot change. Determined. Like Babylon is fallen, is fallen, is fallen. Three times. Not going to change. Okay? Some that cannot be changed. It's stable. It's determined. Number four means when God likes something or doesn't like something. Number six, for instance, means worldly. Number seven means perfect, complete. 7 days, the week of creation was complete, was perfect. How many times should I forgive my neighbor? And Jesus said, 70 times seven. Jesus did not say 490 times, and then if he sins again, you don't have to forgive him again. Jesus said, complete, as many times as it takes, forever. Mary, seven demons out of her. If it was five, I would believe. If it was eight, I would believe. But because he says seven, anybody, even a kid in Israel, would tell you it was not seven demons. It was full of demons. It was a perfect number, complete. She was taken over by demons. The same, Elijah prayed seven times. He didn't pray seven times. In the Hebrew culture, when it says there, anybody in Israel knows he prayed as long as he took. Complete number. And then 10, 8 means righteous, 10 means norm or law or rule, norm. 12 means variety, diversity. 14 means Yahweh, God, and so on. I don't remember, I read a book on it, I don't remember all the numbers. So I gave a little, you asked me what it means in Hebrew. Questions, do you have more questions? Yes. The sanctuary prayer?
No, it's a kind that's more new agey.
Oh, contemplative prayer. So listen carefully to what I say. This is big. This is big. There are two extremes, and Satan would love if we go in either of them. People who go into oriental influence, oriental meditation, you empty your brain. I don't know how to do that. I'm not able to empty my brain. My brain goes all the time. Until I die, my brain, it will keep going. Okay? Empty your brain and think about nothing. How can you think about nothing? Doesn't make much sense for me. Think about the middle eye. Duh, I don't have a middle eye. I have just two. One in left, one in right. That's oriental religion. Satan wants you to do that so he can get access in your brain to manipulate you. The other extreme, don't meditate. Don't wait for an answer. Say your prayer and run. It's dangerous to The word contemplate, the word meditate have been hijacked. There is meditation in the Bible. It says in Psalm 119, day and night I meditate upon your law. In fact, I have 4 pages with paragraphs from the Spirit of Prophecy about meditation. For instance, these are of ages. When every voice is hushed, the quietness of our mind makes possible to hear the voice of God. He says, be still and know that I am God. And then she says, we should meditate. We should be quiet and meditate upon his character. And then she says, at the foot of the cross, contemplating the last days of Jesus' life and the sacrifice, we are changed. So the Spirit of Christ talks about meditation. The Bible talks about meditation. But not the way they understand meditation. When they talk about meditation, they talk about emptying your brain and think of nothing. That's not biblical. Every single time, literally, 100%, no exception, every single time in the Bible or Spirit of Prophecy, when he talks about meditation, contemplation, reflection, it gives you the object of your meditation. You don't meditate upon nothing. It is always upon God, his character, his sacrifice, his law, his word. It gives you the object. You don't meditate on nothing. In fact, Ellen White says, instead of emptying your brain, she says we should fill our mind with God's law. So basically, it's the other way around. Don't empty your brain. Better fill your brain with Christ. You see my point? So contemplation, meditation are good, but they have been hijacked, and people go in extremes. Some of them oriental influence, and some of them are afraid of that, so they never contemplate. They read quick, say a word there, and leave. Those extremes are bad both. You got to study, but fill your heart and your mind with God. Yes?
There are some, I understand, that will take that concept and they'll talk about, you know, meditate on a Bible story or something, and then picture Jesus coming to you, and he's going to tell you something, give you a message, and then, you know, people just imagine what Jesus is telling them, and then they'll take that as God's direction for them.
I cannot afford to imagine anything. I just study carefully. I go deep into the Word. I don't go deep into my brain. Because there is nothing good in my brain. I just go deep into the Word. And I keep praying, because as long as I keep praying, Satan has no access. Okay, now listen carefully. When he says there, be still and know that I am God, the Greek, actually Hebrew there, it's in the Old Testament, doesn't even say be still and know that I am God. The words are Rapha, be still, and Yada, know. Well, Rapha doesn't mean to be still, to be quiet. It's a different word, to be quiet. Rapha means slow down, calm down, don't be anxious. When you come into God's presence, basically he says, calm down. Lord, I have this problem, I have this problem. Calm down. You're not going to solve the problems in this second. And you cannot solve them even if you are consumed. You cannot even change the color of your hair. I mean, you can, but it's not going to change it, really. Okay, so the Lord says, calm down. When you come into my presence, forget problems. Calm down for a second. Relax. That's what it means. And then, after you calm down, and know, it's not the word for knowledge. It's yada. Yada is what God told Adam to do with Eve. When God created them, he said, know your wife and have children. It means to have an intimate relationship. So the Lord says, when you come into my presence, slow down, forget problems. Have a relationship with me. You follow? That's prayer. Questions? We have about 5 more minutes. Nobody. Man, you got everything. Yes?
Okay, on forgiveness. If you, sometimes like you know that you should be sorry about something, but you're not. Can you still ask for forgiveness? Like, how do you?
Oh, you know that it's bad, but you love it.
Yeah.
Well, really, I'm not sure you can ask for forgiveness unless you are sorry, because it's metanoia. Metanoia, repentance, means when you are deeply sorry of what you did and you want to change, but you don't have the power. And if you like it and you don't want to change, that's not metanoia. So basically, probably you should pray a different prayer. Lord, do whatever it takes to help me hate sin, be sorry for sin. Though you may not have power, you don't have power to change. But you need to be sorry. You need to really feel remorse, to feel like, man, it's horrible what I did. I'm really sorry. And I know I cannot change. And yes, it can happen that on one side you like it, and one side you hate it, because there are two natures fighting in us. But you nevertheless have to hate it too. Okay? That was a tricky one. Okay. Any other questions? Well, I say again what I said before. If I lose my time here instead of being with my family, and you don't make a decision, that's bad. I'm going to give you a story and finish, okay? I could give you another 100 stories, but we don't have time anymore. I don't know how many of you know Lisa Cluzet and Dr. Ron Cluzet. Dr. Ron Cluzet did net evangelism in Nashville 2 years ago. He is the director of North American Division Evangelism Institute. He teaches in Andrews evangelism classes, okay? He was my teacher when I was in college there. And Dr. Cluzet had a week of revival. And he would teach about prayer and how the Holy Spirit comes and so on. And he told us a story about his wife, Lisa Cluzet. And he said, you know, my wife was very upset with me because God answers my prayers and God doesn't answer her prayers. Oh yeah, God answers yours because you are a pastor, you are a priest. I said, nah, honey, I don't have more merits before God or more power. We are just the same. And God would answer a prayer of a child or a prayer of the thief on the cross. God answers every honest prayer. Jesus didn't say, if you are a pastor, I will answer. He says, whatever you ask in my name, you'll receive. You just have to believe that you already got it. You have to believe that you already got it. So, he said, honey, the problem is not that I am a pastor and you are not. The problem is that you don't pray. Oh, yeah, I pray every day. No, honey, that's poetry. That's no prayer what you do. You say the same formula every day. You don't even think. Oh, she got upset with him. Yeah, you say that. It's easy. You are a pastor. I am a nurse. I have a real job. When they do that, I feel like... I had an elder who told me, get a real job. And I told him, I want you either to spend 2 days with me or to resign. I will not work with you. He said, oh, really? I said, really. I'm going to call the whole board, call the church, call the conference. You either spend 2 days with me or you resign. I'm not going to work with you. And he said, okay, I spend 2 days with you. I can come Monday and Thursday. Good. He came. After half day, he said, I don't know how you can take it. My phone was ringing all the time. I was running all the time. He said, this is crazy. This is crazy. I said, well, do you want to get my job now? Or do you want me to get a real job? And he was quiet. Pastor, I apologize. I'm sorry. You are forgiven. Go and sin no more. So, when they say that, I have a real job, they have no clue. Okay. So, Lisa says to Ron, I have a real job. I cannot wake up like you at 4 a.m. and pray. He said, honey, you don't love Jesus. Oh, I love Jesus. Yeah, words. Love is not what you say. It's what you prove. Basically, if you love him, you spend time with him, and you never spend time with him. I love him too. No, you don't. Well, I cannot wake up early. You know that I sleep hard. Yeah, she sleeps hard. He told us that he sleeps so light that if a door would move in the whole house, he would hear from his bedroom and wake up. If the phone would ring, they had an old dial-up. Do you remember those phones? With the wheel? Crazy, do you remember? And when the phone would ring, like, that would, you know, wake you even from the dead. He would hear the click. There is a clink that the phone does before it starts ringing. Clink. He would hear the clink and jump from his sleep and pick up the phone. He sleeps so light. On the other hand, she sleeps so hard that you can fire a cannon by her ear and she will not wake up. You can chop wood on her body and she will not wake up. I'm kidding. And she literally, he says, that she got a stainless steel plate and she had a big clock that had two things and a little hammer in between them, and the alarm would go off and the hammer would do that, and she put spoons on the plate around the clock, on the stainless steel plate. When the hammer would go off, the spoons would do that, and she would still not wake up. And he would get frustrated, and he would stop the clock, and she would sleep and snore, and he would, honey, wake up. Huh? Kind of. So she says, honey, I cannot wake up. I sleep hard. And he says, well, you don't like to wake up. No, I cannot. Ask God to wake you up. He said, no, I sleep hard. And he says, you tell me that God has no power to wake you up? Well, I'm not saying that. Then ask him, well, I sleep hard. Honey, you don't want to wake up. You love to sleep in. You just love sleep more than you love God. Period. I said, well, if you put it that way, no, I love God more than sleep. Then ask him to wake you up, and you got to mean what you ask for him to answer. If you ask as a form, he's not going to answer. You got to mean it with all your heart. She got it. That night she went to sleep, and she said, Lord, I am playing church. I never have a relationship with you. I don't know you. And I want you to come into my life, and I want you to wake me up so we have a relationship. Do whatever it takes. Wake me up tomorrow whenever you want. Next morning, 5 a.m., 5:15, I believe, I don't remember, 5:30, somewhere, next morning, she hears the phone ringing. And she hears the phone, again, and 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 again. And she's like in a dream. Man, am I dreaming? Or it's keep, oh, it's like for the last 20 minutes, it keeps ringing, and it doesn't stop. And she would not, she was kind of very hard to open her eyes. She was fighting, and eventually she opened her eyes. And she says, the phone is ringing, actually. And now she was awake. The phone was ringing. And she says, we have an answering machine. They had an old answering machine with a little tape that you would have to rewind and then listen. You know what I'm talking about? And the answering machine was set to kick in after the fourth ring. And she says, it keeps ringing, and the answering machine is on, and it doesn't answer. And they had a caller ID that had big red letters, all stuff. And she looks and he says, 0000. That's strange. And then she says, Ron is here. He's still sleeping. He's not in his room praying. And he doesn't hear the phone. He's dead. She jumps over him. She takes his pulse. He is sleeping like a baby. And she says, I hear the phone. He doesn't hear. The answering machine doesn't answer. This is crazy. And she picks up. Calls at 5 a.m. and all this stuff happens. Hello! And she hears a voice. Lisa, I'm here waiting for you. It's time to pray.
That was scary.
That was scary.
Well, didn't Jesus talk to Abraham?
Yeah.
Or Moses? Yeah. Didn't angels come and visit? Doesn't Jesus say that many times you received angels and you didn't even know? God never changed. God did it, does it, will do it again. And I don't want to give you more stories, but it happens. I could give you more stories like this. So when Dr. Cluzet said that, I said, oh, come on. He said, well, go and ask Lisa. I did. I talked to Lisa, and she said to me, when that happened, I froze. She said, literally, I froze. And she said, I was afraid to move. I put the phone back on the fork, and after closing the phone, I got by my bed, and I said, Lord, forgive me. And she said, it came in my mind right away, I am here by your bed every morning waiting that you wake up and have a relationship with me for your benefit, and you don't wake up. It's time that you change that. And she said to me, Pavel, never since, it has never happened again to go one morning without serious prayer. She said, I am not going to leave that house without spending time with God, even if I die. I don't care if I lose my job. I don't care if I lose my life. It's better for me to lose my job than to lose my God. And she said, we don't know what we miss. I said, the Lord is waiting for you there. And you ignore it and run through the door. Think about it. We don't pray because we are too comfortable and because we don't want to change. When we pray, we change, and we don't want that. So, saying that, we finished. It was good to spend time with you, and it's even better for me to go home. Okay. Let's have a closing prayer. And then I have two more Bible classes, and I'm out of here. I hope that you are blessed, and I really pray and hope that you will do something about it. And listen, it may happen that you make a decision and then you sleep again. The Bible says that the righteous falls seven times, but he gets up again every time. So even if it happens to me too. I pray, and then one day I don't pray. And everything goes upside down. I don't give up. Next day I go back to prayer. So when it happens, go back to prayer. Don't give up. Don't get discouraged. Okay? You got it? Okay. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for desiring to have a relationship with us. Thank you for being such a wonderful God. And thank you for what you will do for these young people and for this school. Not based on who we are, but based on who you are. We pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen.